So hello, everyone. Thank you for having me here. I'm Michal Purzynski, or Michal Purzynski, or Michał Purzynski, depends. I mean, I can recognize each and every one of them. I will just start by saying that I'm probably today not the only non-native speaker. So, you know, if something is not easy to understand, just, you know, interrupt me whenever you want. I'm doing the network security in Mozilla, which is part of the operation security, or the new name is, I think, Enterprise Information Security, because we got a rebranding recently. So now we are enterprise level, whatever. Works for me. And there is a couple of other smart people in the team. I'm just doing mostly bro stuff and trying to correlate network security with some other things. But what I'm also doing is not just the security, but also trying to use bro to help other teams. And these teams come from various places, like web operations teams, network operations teams. And you know, when you deploy ideas or something for network security in the organization, at least a large organization, at the beginning, your network security team is like, oh no, we are not doing it. Because you are going to plug all the tabs everywhere, and things have been working for ages, and no one was unplugging the connections, the fibers. So now when we unplug things, plug tabs, and plug everything back, things will stop working. I know it. But basically, we try to build a system that would be useful for other teams. So we will see a couple of examples how bro was used mostly to help in other than security, and also including security kind of work. So yeah, I will tell you how we use bro to protect infrastructure, to discover some kind of a what happened if we had the data disclosure. I will talk more about the data disclosure later, but it's actually the most common problem for us. How we solved a huge problem working with a network team for an overloaded firewall. What do we do when there is a new vulnerability, and how can bro help for it? Some kind of very interesting DDoS firefighting. This is a very interesting one, and I will talk more about it much later, but it's interesting because it ends with a very funny conclusion. And brute forcing, how do we detect, what can we tell about running bro for like over 2 years about brute forcing attacks? And some thoughts about correlation ideas and some notices, how you should do correlation, what is a bad idea to do for a correlation, and so on. So basically, the first question that everyone tells and asks is, wait a second, you're Mozilla, so you care about user privacy so much, and you have an NSM system, and it reads users' data. This just seems wrong. That something is not really working here. No, it does not read user data. That's the first important thing. What we are trying to do is to prevent your Firefox from being backdoored. We are trying to protect the infrastructure and not obviously spy on users. So yeah, protect the infrastructure, or just protect the Fox or a little foxes. And as for user data, you might be thinking about Firefox accounts. For those of you who don't really use Firefox accounts, it's a cloud-hosted infrastructure. Basically, when you enable Firefox accounts or Firefox sync in your Firefox browser, it stores a lot of data on our site. But an important thing to say here is the data is encrypted on your site, shipped to us as a binary object that we don't really read. We cannot read it because we don't have keys. The keys are generated on your site and stored on your site. So we don't really have any means to decrypt your data. And what kind of data it might be? Browser history, browser settings, things like what kind of add-ons you have installed. So when you have yet another Firefox on your phone or on your tablet or a Firefox OS phone or yet another laptop, you can just go and synchronize each of the settings with the primary Firefox in like a few clicks of a mouse and, you know, just giving a password and it works. But we don't have access to this data. But it's also interesting because you can even use Bro to detect attacks, not understanding the underlying binary objects. I will show it later. So yeah, that's the primary thing. Firefox OS cannot be read by us. We can only look at the metadata. A very short infrastructure overview. That's basically two data centers. I put it as 1+1 because we are getting rid of one of them. Two business units. Business unit for us is like a separate data center inside the data center, whatever. I mean, the separated one is connected only on the border, the border routers. A few offices, 5 is actually what I'd like it to be. For now, it's 3 offices and 2 of them are on the way. So we are monitoring with Bro the outbound traffic from the offices. Again, not because we are interested what are people doing in our office, because we are not, obviously. I will tell you more that we actually even have a guest network where you are basically free to do whatever you want as long as it's separated and we almost don't filter it. I mean, it's for research purposes. If you want to do research in the gas network, it's fine, but you will be monitored. AWS is on the way, mostly because we are moving some kind of products and cloud gapping them, at least the most dangerous things, we are moving to AWS. So that's like 14 sensors in the main data center, 10 of them are Bro, we are doing some full packet capture, we are doing some Suricata. Hate to be the one that mentions Suricata from this place, but yes, we do it. And why so much capacity? I mean, we have like 20 gigs of traffic, all of it that we actually monitor. Because, you know, DDoS happens. And when the DDoS comes, I want to have at least some partial capability to understand it with Bro. Because with Bro, you've got all these protocol analyzers and can actually understand what the DDoS is all about and how it's trying to exploit your network to basically cut it off. For example, in some kind of amplification attacks or some very interesting HTTP abusing DDoS. I want to understand it, and it gives me so much more than the pure NetFlow data that will just tell me, okay, there was a flow, and I think it was from here to here. But each and every one of you that have seen NetFlow data have seen many times that the NetFlow can get wrong, the source and destination can get reversed, and basically what is there is the source destination IP amount of data that is estimated only. So it's not really a good tool. So right now we are shipping like 20 gigabits to sensors. The important thing to mention here is it does not mean that we have 20 gigs at the border. Sometimes we do. It means we are inspecting lots of internal traffic because I'm kind of paranoid here and I want Bro to see most of the from VLAN to VLAN traffic, the internal traffic. Even if not for detection, but at least if we have some incident, I can basically recreate what just happened. So having the internal traffic is very useful. Sensors are pretty typical, you know, the Miricom cards, 64 or 128 gigs of RAM, some number, of course, depending on how old the hardware is. The important thing to note here is we decided not to go for the 3-something gigahertz cores, because if you go this way, first of all, the CPU is really expensive, and second, there is a limited number of cores there. So instead, I'd rather have like more cores, slightly slower, but if you have a good cooling and a good settings in a firmware and on the operation system, it actually is 3.0 gigahertz all the time, nonstop. And it kind of feels like you are getting something for free here, because you can have 14 cores and all of them can work on 3 gigahertz all the time for like 2 years, no problem. So I would say we push like 3.5 gigabit per sensor, easy, no packet loss. except when the packet loss happens somewhere before bro, like on a span port or something. There is a lot of supporting infrastructure, and it's not just built for bro. It has been built for just the operation security needs. The intelligence server, which is like something that, you know, gets all these famous intelligence lists. You know, all these lists that will tell you that, for example, Mozilla is a very dangerous place to visit, because Mozilla is, for example, an executable source. Yes, we are. We are serving Firefox.exe. So, yeah. So we are on several, if not all of the intelligence lists as an executable source. I guess a pretty good one. Anyway, CIF, you probably know this project, Common Intelligence Framework. You basically collect some, have it collect some data, and it processes them, and it can do the output in various ways, including the output from the Bro Intelligence Framework. Some builders, because we build our own Bro packages, not because we don't trust someone, but just because we have some very crazy options or patches from the Bro team for fixing things. Or for example, in case of the Bro-cat, we were using the 2.4 version early enough in the 2.3 Bro because it was so much faster. So it was just in the package I built. And MozDev. Okay, let's see how visible is the MozDev thing. So what is MozDev? MozDev is our log aggregation solution. And it basically is here in place of, I don't know, people use like ArcSight or Splunk or any other similar tools. So it's basically of the same category. More of an ArcSight. We used to use ArcSight. The ArcSight was in Mozilla for several years. Then we hired someone who actually started building his own CM. I guess that's more or less how it. Wait a second. It was a. Yeah. So MozDev basically collects all the data. You can see it generates a lot of alerts. It's actually much more than just a log aggregator. You can see right here, I will stop for a second, then for each of the alerts, you have obviously some category and so on. But every alert in MozDev, we want to be actionable. We want to do something about the alert. If your bro generates alerts that you cannot do anything about, and these alerts don't really provide any kind of context value, you might think about not generating this alert. Because, you know, you want to generate something that you can either act on or get some background data whenever an investigation comes, and you want to learn what was some host doing a few weeks before. If none of these are met by your alert, you just should give up. That's my take on it. You don't want to be generating a constant stream of alerts because people stop reacting to them. So we are very careful about what kind of alerts we send to MozDev. MozDev takes this alert, provides a nice graphical representation. I will show it later. But for example, for this brute forcing attempt, I don't know if it's visible, but the first one from the top is for some brute forcing to SSH. So we can get some contextual information like dshield, IP intelligence, who is, and basically check if the IP attacking us has been registered on an intelligence list and what kind of information do they have about it, like from several sources. So MozDev allows you to basically pivot to several different sources of information from one place, which is nice. If you decide you want to block this IP, it's also interesting because, you know, you just have this standard blocking interface, but what you have in the middle is plugins, and you can write plugins for MozDev. The first one is Firefox accounts. So Firefox accounts, Firefox Sync is hosted in the cloud. So the mechanism for blocking things in the cloud are obviously different than the mechanism for blocking in a data center on a physical hardware. So this is interesting because it allows you to, for example, spot an IP brute forcing your data center, and you can block it in some other places, like, for example, in the cloud, and the IP hasn't yet started scanning your cloud. So you are like, okay, we know this IP is bad, and you know, if you see it, just drop all the packets from it for like an hour or so. We also participate in the Facebook exchange, so if we see something interesting, then we can basically, you know, tick a box and have it sent to Facebook. Yeah, you can type a bug number, whatever. We use Bugzilla for everything. You block it, and it's done. Behind it is a same system that Justin presented. It's something we have written ourselves, which is a black hole routing in case of a physical data center, and it's Elastic load balancer in case of AWS. We don't use just BGP, we use FlowSpec. FlowSpec is actually much more, so much different from a traditional BGP updates, although it uses BGP for blocking IPs. If you want to know more about the difference, just, you know, catch me later. I'm here all week. The interesting part is you can escalate the alert. If you saw something really bad, you can escalate it. You can click on the type of alert, see what kind of previous alerts has this host generated. Because we don't want MozDev to be just a place when you can look at all the alerts and block IPs. We want to log in inside to MozDev and basically work inside MozDev on all the investigation and incidents. I will show it in a second. So here is something like, you know, a large amount of HTTP errors. When I told you about this investigation phase and incident phase, I really mean it. So for example, when you escalate it, you get a whole new bunch of tabs to fill, and you can basically conduct your investigation step by step. From the just description, what just happened, what you saw, indicators, evidence, some kind of notes, some kind of theory you have about it, what do you think really happened. And everything is updated constantly, like in a few seconds, so multiple operation security people can log in and work on a single case at the same time. You know, some mitigations, what have you learned? This is important. This is actually my favorite part because we are collecting information after the incident. Okay, this is what we have learned from this incident. For example, we should have monitored GitHub accounts for leaking credentials or something like this. Let me skip a little bit. Yeah, this is awesome. So this is actually our interface to Banhammer. Banhammer is the is something that we use to block bad guys from accessing our networks. Someone just got this idea, but it would be really nice to have it like this. Yes, these are like ogres, and each of them has this little thingy on it. When you hover a mouse on it, you can basically see what kind of IP it is, if it has been known from a previous attack. The blocked one is basically dressed, is in some kind of a little shield, like this one in the background. The front is naked, so if the host is naked, it means it hasn't been blocked yet. I will leave this arbitrary choice with no discussion whatsoever. Obviously, everything is in like HTML, JavaScript, so you can pivot from one place to another. Finally, you can blog it in the same, basically, way. Here is yet another interface, kind of a classic one. Everyone has something like this, so we do as well. Like, you know, looking at where the attacks are coming from and how some parts of the world are active in attacking us. Obviously, some kind of filtering in the categories. So, for example, right now I'm filtering for what I'm filtering here, HTTP errors, yeah. and so on. Basically, we try to send as much as it is possible from the notices from Bro to MozDev, and MozDev is the tool to respond to everything, including investigations. Speaking about one more thing about sensors itself, we decided to go very restrictively, to basically harden every sensor as much as we can. So there is like an Ubuntu standard thing. Nothing special about it, but it's hardened. It runs only the software that it should run, which sometimes when I look at the NSM sensors is not that obvious in other places. We were trying to do as much as possible of hardening against kernel exploits. You know, host-based firewall, we trust our networks. That's why we separate from our network as much as we can, just in case. Very strict rules. You cannot log into sensors from anywhere except from like three hosts in a data center. Obviously, SSH with keys, do I have to even say it? And the future, something I'd like to explore more, maybe by the end of this year, is sandboxing Bro using whatever sandboxing mechanism are in Linux. There are a few. And it would be really nice to sandbox at least workers. So when malicious traffic comes to worker and you in some way can get the remote code execution in Bro, I don't even know if it's possible, but if it would be, it would be really nice to have workers sandboxed, because they are, in theory, parsing a very dangerous traffic, at least on our side. So, you know, decided to protect from everything as much as it can be. From RC local, I will show you just a single thing. Where it is? Oh, yeah. So we are, after the host rebooted, I guess I should probably do it in a more elegant way and just do some blacklisting. But I'm removing all the modules that were not necessary, that are not necessary after the host booted, just, you know, to minimize the exposure. IP tables and this part with syscontrol. I'm trying and I'm basically disabling all the ways to load modules. Once I have the set of modules loaded on the sensor, I don't want the module loading mechanism to be enabled again because I don't need it. The working sensor doesn't need it. And a lot of kernel exploits were based on, for example, opening a socket with some very old network protocol that had a lot of easily exploitable bugs. And when you have module loading enabled, this module with this protocol will be loaded and exploited. So this is kind of a hack, but it works. The very challenging thing for us is good luck protecting things by removing capabilities from our network. What I mean is we cannot do too much of egress filtering. And I hope it doesn't scare you too much, but for example, in offices, most of the traffic is allowed, and it has to be. When you think about Mozilla, despite the corporation in name, we are not a corporation. We are a research and development place. That's what it mostly is. Bring your own whatever you want, connect it everywhere. If some developer cannot connect whatever he wants, wherever he wants, you will get complaints, and these complaints will come from from the very top, because we give our people a lot of freedom in using whatever tools they want. And yeah, that's basically it. You cannot restrict too much. So our only hope is basically on detection and filtering of the obviously bad things. Obviously, we have tons of cloud technologies. And some of our devices in our network speak with some vendors out there, which is also impossible to block. And basically, you cannot slow down development on the photo on the slide. You can see that some developer has like, I don't know, 5 laptops here, desktops, whatever. The flow of data from Bro is quite easy and very unique to us. We use Bro. Bro is shipping things to basically text files. Hekka is picking these text files. If you don't know Hekka, it is a log processor, basically kind of like a log stash. But if I say Hekka is a log stash, you know, I will have troubles after coming back, because obviously Hekka is so much better than a log stash. And I'm not kidding you, Hekka is able to parse 15 gigabits per second of logs per single core doing some things to it. Obviously, it kind of depends what it's doing, but I have seen systems with a powerful CPU processing 15 gigabits per second of logs per physical core. It was really awesome. I mean, over loopbacks, so I guess over the network it would be much easier, but I'm quite convinced that 10 gigabits shouldn't be a problem. Hekka can execute Lua scripts for doing something to the data. For example, if you have load balancers, then the Lua script will take the real IP of the client and put it in the source IP. So you don't see the source IP of the load balancer, but the source IP of a real client. Everything gets shipped to RabbitMQ and to MozDev. Okay, moving to the second part. How are we looking over time? Great. Case, data disclosure. So this is actually something that happens a lot. Someone just by mistake pasted a credential somewhere on a paste bin or uploaded a configuration file with everything and credentials, SSH keys, whatever, on GitHub. It happens to everyone. It happens so much if you have a lot of developers working on thousands of projects. So basically you want to understand if the site that data were pasted on is on your in your data center. You want to understand who accessed this data, kind of measure the damage that was done. Because sometimes, always you take this data out so they are not public anymore, but you need to understand when the data was pasted and the time frame before we blocked it and removed. We changed the credentials after it, but we'd like to understand if someone outside of Mozilla accessed them. So with bro connection logs, this is actually really good because you can tell if the IPs accessing it were from Moco or not Moco, which is a short for a Mozilla corporation. And you can correlate, you know. If you don't know this IP that accessed this piece of data, you basically look into SSH log, HTTP log, and for example, you can say it pretty much looks like our employee because he is logging every day, 8 a.m. or something, into some host through SSH or through VPN. You correlate with OpenVPN logs. You ask the person, you reach out to this person, and you can tell that, okay, the data were public for like 3 hours, and everyone who were using this data, everyone who accessed them, is actually employee of Mozilla. Yeah, Michal will show the HTTP headers. Actually, a very simple script, but it shows how powerful Bro is and something that you cannot really do on most of the commercial IDSs. I have put together a very simple short script that basically extracts the one of the headers and puts it inside the HTTP log and also in the Intel framework. So we have a real client IP because this X cluster client IP is the IP of the real client. Just something useful to have. And it allows for a lot of good correlation. Switching to an overloaded firewall. This is an interesting one. So one day we've got this call from a Relange team. Relange team is doing release engineering, basically building and releasing new Firefoxes. And yeah, the firewall they were using between the cloud and the on-premise infrastructure, the data center infrastructure, was dying from the traffic. It had a lot of packet drops, and the network team reached out to us to kind of understand what is inside of the network, because you cannot tell it from the NetFlow data, because you have just HTTP port 80, good luck if you know what is there. And like 99% of our traffic is HTTP. So yeah, good luck. What we did as the first step was kind of approximation. I will show the script in a few seconds, but I basically put together a very simple script that takes incoming bytes out and the bytes sent for each of the subnetworks. I'm using a simplification here and decided that the subnet would be like /24 all the time. And every like 15 minutes or something, this script logs that, for example, from this subnet, so much data was sent, so much data has been received. So at least after running it for a couple of hours, we knew which networks, which subnets are responsible for most of the traffic. And I really mean that approximation like this sometimes can be so much better than nothing else if you don't really have any other way. So let's see what do we send over IPsec, yet another script. And this one, when I actually pinpointed the very network responsible for most of the traffic, I did per host. I couldn't do per host right away at the start, at the beginning, because we have too many hosts and we had a lot of memory used on the bro side. And you can see per host how much the host sent, how much the host received. And for example, in the last line, in the send bytes, something here is clearly visible that it's sending like a lot of data. So you are starting to take a look at this very host and so on. You can understand what do you actually send in a network that has been up and running for a while and no one really has up-to-date information about it. We also did some, you know, top traffic destinations and so on to kind of learn about the host names that are generating most of the traffic. Scripts, yeah. So switching to script that generated it. Do I have it? 1 second. It's actually a very simple script. One of them is actually a very simple script using summary statistics framework. On a connection state remove, you basically log how much data has been sent and received. That's basically it. It's very trivial. And you can add here, you know, like you can do it per host. You can add information about the protocol that has been in use. And you log it every 60 minutes. This script is somewhere on a GitHub, on my GitHub. And it's really trivial. It should be like a lesson number one in using some stats. But even this simple script is very useful to understand what is going on in your network if you suddenly have a lot of traffic and you don't really know what is generating it. And we have learned a lot running these simple scripts. Like the most important were that we were sending Firefox binaries built in the cloud because part of the Firefox build happens in AWS. We were sending it back to our data center so they could be signed because we've got the signing infrastructure for security reasons in a physical form on a separated servers with HSM and everything. And renting HSM at some vendor is first of all very expensive. Second, you might not trust the vendor so much to actually have keys to sign like a Firefox release. So we have it in our data center and we're sending these files back. Obviously, we actually overloaded the firewall with not only this, but also we discovered that all the hosts in AWS were sending every single DNS query back to a local data center. And at this point, we learned that it was like 80% of the connections between AWS and data center coming from DNS. So a dying firewall has been saved. Someone told me that after running this script for like an hour or so, we saved almost a gigabit of total bandwidth, like 70, 62 of outbound. And yeah, this is actually the case where Bro has saved a lot of money on hardware upgrades because we couldn't really extend this firewall anymore. So instead we would have to go and buy a pair of new firewalls with powerful cards and everything, you know. This is an interesting one, a case of new vulnerability. So whenever a new vulnerability is published, we actually wonder if we run the affected software. And yes, we do have vulnerability management systems that log in into every system and check for the software installed there and so on. But you can miss some things in a very dynamic environment like ours. It might just happen that you cannot log into some servers and Bro can see all the software versions over the network. So it's really cool. You can ask Bro if you saw exploitation attempts in the past. It so happened with the Shellshock vulnerability, where we were basically going back and trying to understand if someone succeeded in using Shellshock on us. No one ever did, fortunately. Very nice thing here, if you have a problem with a lot of diverse clients using very different TLS and whatever version, if there is a new vulnerability in a TLS or some cyber suit has been broken and you need to disable it, you can, thanks to Bro, actually tell if you can disable it, because you will tell if you have some clients using it and how many of the clients will be impacted. For us, we cannot just disable a cyber suit because it's old, but we have to actually communicate to the upper management how many users will be impacted, because we have users downloading new Firefox on a, for example, a very old Windows XP or something. This single line is actually how Bro saw a lot of Shellshock attempts. Lines like this are very useful because you grab old logs to understand if there were some exploitation attempts. You will not just understand if the attempt has succeeded, but you know, just take a look at this previous line. Like I said on this slide, it's a feedback loop. When you see a line like this, you have a lot of information to add to your intelligence systems. You know, you have like this IP here and the name of the file to look for on a local systems. So you basically, from this single line, can extract a lot of IOC data, put this IOC data all over your sensors, even the sensors that that didn't see this malicious traffic yet. And if they see this traffic, well, we'll at least notify you. It's really nice. So I would say the most important part during the incident is not just focusing on the incident itself, but collecting the IOCs discovered and feeding it back to Bro. On a beautiful day, we've got this thing, and it was really bad. What it means is actually I reused the old, I think it's somewhere in the Bro source. I don't think I wrote the script and neither do anyone else from my team. So it's somewhere in the Bro code. It's looking for too many HTTP errors coming from a single IP. And we saw these two log messages. They are not so strange and not so unusual to be seen, but if you look here, it's actually part of our subnet, of our public subnet, and it's the source IP. So why are we generating HTTP errors to our own site from our own site? This is really interesting. And following it, we start seeing a lot of services on our load balancers dying, like HG, FTP, and so on. There was a tree closure, and what it means is release engineering basically stopped. It couldn't do any useful work. We saw a lot of services impacted, and it wasn't like 404 or something, but 503, which is load balancer is having troubles. Not the backend, but load balancers. I started doing a summary on the hosts that were causing HTTP errors from the Bro logs, and what I saw is, first of all, this IP reported in these logs is indeed generating a lot of errors, but we can see a very long tail of the AWS IPs. So is someone attacking us from AWS and from our data center? Not so much. So it turned out that this IP attacking us is actually one of our source nuts, and there is a lot of machines behind it. I correlated access from AWS to what we know about our AWS infrastructure. Turns out all these IPs attacking us from AWS are ours. So yeah, we are basically DOSing ourselves in a very effective way, because it works, because everything starts dying. The release engineering team wasn't so happy hearing it. We engaged the network operations, the web operations, and so on. We correlated a lot of information. We confirmed, yes, we are DDoSing ourselves. What happened here is someone pushed a new script that was doing some kind of automation and testing, fetching a lot of data from HG, but between each of the two subsequent fetches of the code from HD, the cache, the local cache on the disk was cleared completely. So suddenly we saw like 10,000 of systems trying to clone a full Firefox repository at the same time. And it was it. That's what happened. So we basically stopped this script and everything started working again. Now, try to do it with without something like bro in the strategic places. You would not be able to correlate, for example, this public IP here, because, okay, it's a source NAT, but now you don't really know. Now you don't really know what is behind this. And our bro infrastructure allows us to see both the traffic before and after the NAT. So it was very easy to correlate, mostly using HTTP log, because I could see the traffic to HG coming. Okay, 5 minutes, so I will just skip on the brute forcing. Not so much interesting, all kinds of HTTP and mostly SSH. Brute forcing to HTTP generates errors, so if you collect information about errors on your site, it might be like people trying XSS or other vulnerabilities. Everything basically happens on the application layer. The power that bro gives you here is, for example, if you brute force Bugzilla, oh my God, it's gonna be public now. If you brute force Bugzilla, it's gonna respond every single time with 200, okay, I'm fine, you can brute force me all day long. I will not return a single error. So in order for you to actually understand if Bugzilla is being brute forced, you have to parse the HTTP. I don't know why, but that's what it is. And with bro doing something like this is easy. An example of this will be on GitHub. I won't tell about, no, not this script because it's huge. just a few vendor surprises. Yeah, like you see, I won't be reading them. Some of the old cyber suits and so on. Some of Playtank's authentication over HTTP. If you do something like this, you might think about, you know, turning on SSL, but yeah, whatever. Some thoughts about correlation. You know, just like crazy ideas I had. We've got this PE analyzer right now in bro, and I guess that most of the PE files are very incorrect, not signed, lack a lot of the signatures that the properly built software is built with. So probably by analyzing the PE, you can tell a malware executable. Reach out to me later if you want to know what I mean. You know, just extracting bro files, sending bro data to Tableau for some kind of interpretation later. Suricata again, so I like to use bro for resolving Suricata alerts, and I do. Usually bro logs are enough to tell if the alert has been real or not. And yeah, correlation is hard. If you alert on everything, you will get alerts all the time, obviously. There is a DNS prefetching in browsers. If you put the Intel list with all the DNS stuff in bro, it will go off all the time without any host being exploited. You try to do DNS plus connections. So for example, a host not only resolved the DNS name, but also connected. You have to know if the host on the other side is really malicious or not, because not every connection is actually bad. But at least there is something you can investigate. Bro plus Suricata again. So basically what I said, trying to resolve Suricata alerts with bro. I got this idea, and it's a very good one, from CrowdStrike scripts. Basically alert on multiple Intel hits, or alert on multiple notices, or Intel plus notice. But unfortunately, all I got was a brand new scanner detection, and not so much of a different tool, because it was basically going off all the time, because each and every host was being scanned from multiple sources. All of these sources were on different Intel hits. So whenever someone was scanning us from a few locations, this was constantly going off. So not so much useful for us, sorry. Something that people actually do a lot is like, okay, I will alert on someone logging into our systems 1 a.m. So guess what? We never sleep. It's a global organization. And our people are everywhere. So what it means is you cannot, for example, flag logging someone from Poland or Russia, because we have people working there. So it doesn't really work. All of the scripts are on GitHub, and if not, they will be on GitHub tonight. So if you need some details on some of it, just, you know, reach out to me and questions. Not yet. I'm interested in hearing what do you think you can do with it.
The login is just the session table on every endpoint, and then the IP you expect to see coming from it, at least some localized set of IPs.
Okay, this is an interesting idea. I haven't tried it yet, but like I said, we are just trying to approach the correlation. It's kind of new to us, so you know, every kind of new idea is welcome. Okay.